Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, this is the 8th teaching. And I'm sure by now you have been going through Jericho 2020 with various teachings, workshops, prayers, and you are fully in it. And so I am in a better position now to speak to you. And the topic of this 8th teaching is intercession and mission. Intercession and mission. The moment someone hears these two words, intercession and mission, they will have different connotation in the mind. Intercession, immediately they will say, oh, it's a prayer. Mission, they will say, activity, doing a lot of things. For some people, it's difficult to understand that mission can be also prayer. Or some people, it will be difficult to understand intercession is mission. They will say intercession is sitting in a place and intercede, bus. How can that be a mission? Many people have the wrong idea that mission is only activities. That's why some people think in the church a lot of mission work is going on. If you ask them what are the mission works that is going on in the church, they would simply say the education apostolate, that the missionaries are running so many educational institutions, helping the people to be educated so that they can live a better life. So education apostolate, and so many people, priests, religious, involved in this particular apostolate, the educational apostolate. They are all in the colleges, universities, the schools, the primary schools, at various levels, and that they find it very fulfilling. And also it is a job like for which you are paid, you earn a salary for it. And so this is one of the important mission in the church today. Some people consider that education apostolate. Surely education is an apostolate, a mission. But then that is not the only mission. Some of them think that the health apostolate, running hospitals, being a nurse, doctor, and looking after the patients, treating them, providing them with health tips and facilities. So this is activities, saving the sick people, and that is a mission. Then the next one would be developmental works, social development, upliftment of the poor, the downtrodden, through various projects, social works projects. So they consider it, you visit villages, visit people, and some projects are sanctioned and you are busy executing them, reporting them, taking assessment and reporting all these. So these are activities. So they are social development apostolate. Then there are now alternate ministries, various other activities that we do in the church, and that is called mission, like prison ministry or any other, looking after the differently abled people. These days there are priests, religious, becoming lawyers, becoming doctors, taking up other secular professions and trying to live it and do it, and then they will say these are all mission. But when you say a group of people are interceding, will they consider that as a mission? No. Or they are praying, they are not doing any mission work. So that is a wrong connotation that has got into the mind of so many people. But today we should be able to understand intercession as a mission. In his encyclical, Redemptoris Missio, Saint Pope John Paul II allocated a subsection on prayer and sacrifice for missionaries. The whole encyclical of Redemptoris Missio, that is the mission of the Redeemer, is speaking about missionary activities. But Pope Francis, Pope Saint John Paul II, realizing that intercession is a mission, and it is he who said, intercession is soul and heart of mission. Intercession is soul and heart of mission. And so he gives a subsection in that Redemptoris Missio which deals with prayer and sacrifice for missionaries. In para 78, Pope John Paul II wrote, prayer should accompany the journey of missionaries so that the proclamation of the word will be effective through God's grace. See, prayer should accompany the journey of the missionaries so that the proclamation of the word will be effective through God's grace. See, and then in his letters, Saint Paul often asked the faithful to pray for him so that he might proclaim the gospel with confidence and conviction. So we can simply take the gospel and go around in the street corners and start preaching. But to make it more effective, to touch the hearts of people, we need intercession. To make the proclamation effective, we need intercession. To make the education apostolate effective, that of the mission of Jesus, we need intercession. To make the health apostolate a mission of Jesus, we need intercession. Again, to make any other activities in the name of social development, upliftment of the poor, the downtrodden, we need intercession. Mother Teresa is a beautiful example. Saint Mother Teresa of Calcutta, she did that. If you go to the Mother Teresa Sisters Convent, they are so busy with the daily activities of looking after the poorest of the poor, the leper, the dying destitute, the malnutritious children, the people who have no one to care for, the mentally challenged, all sorts of people are there. 24 hours the sisters are busy, but they have long hours of adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, long prayers. For example, the day Thursday is totally dedicated for prayer and adoration. So all their activities, the more the activities they are, the more they are intercessors. Mother Teresa realized the importance of it, and so she made it a point that in all her communities, intercession is given primary importance. Colossians, St. Paul, in his letter to the Colossians, chapter 4, verse 3, we read, at the same time, pray for us as well, that God will open to us a door for the word. See how beautiful. St. Paul is busy preaching to various churches, and he is asking people to intercede so that through that intercession, when he preaches, God will open the door of the hearts of people who are listening to him. So without intercession, he cannot do the mission. Intercession is mission. And so he says, we may declare the mystery of Christ for which I am in prison, so that I may reveal it clearly as I should. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20, he says, pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. How St. Paul, throughout his ministry, realized the importance of intercession? Again, in his letter to the Romans, chapter 15, verses 30 to 31, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to join me in earnest prayer to God on my behalf. That I may be rescued from the unbelievers in Judea, and that my ministry to Jerusalem may be acceptable to the saints. Again, when he writes in his second letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 3, verse 1, finally, brothers and sisters, pray for us, so that the word of the Lord may spread rapidly and be glorified everywhere, just as it is among you. See these few references that I gave, how Saint Paul, the greatest apostle, the greatest missionary, the one who established so many faith communities, so many churches, that he has realized the importance of intercession for his mission. And he is repeatedly asking everyone who meets, pray that my proclamation may be effective. Pray that those who listen may open their hearts and listen and accept. Their lives may be changed. That is the power of intercession. And that is the mission of intercession. Intercession is mission. I have some examples for you. When Jesus sent the disciples on the mission, he didn't send them individually. You know why? He sent them two by two. When one is doing the proclamation, the other is interceding. So Jesus realized the power of intercession. Without intercession, mission is incomplete. Missionary activity will not have that effect. Will not have that anointing. So the intercession is a must. By the way, what is this intercession? It's intimacy. It's a relationship. It's only those who are related with the Lord can intercede. I cannot just go and meet a stranger and ask him to do something. No. I can only go to those whom I know. I can only go freely to those who love me, whom I love. Those who know me, those whom I know. I can go to them and say, you listen, this is what has to be done. Please do this. I want this to be done. I want that to be done. We can intercede with those people. So intercession is relationship, intimacy. Jesus' whole life was a life of intercession. Why? His relationship with the Father. Jesus, for him, it was his mission was life. Life was mission. And that mission is intercession. All the time with the Father, communicating with the Father, asking the Father, Father, tell me what I have to do. Every time he was having recourse to the Father, intercession. His whole life was a life of intercession, and he is continuing now. He is still a missionary, seated at the right hand of the Father and doing the mission of intercession. Once you get into this, you can do wonders. You can do miracles. Without that, you will do many things. You will turn the world upside down. Nothing will happen. Because the anointing is not there. Because Jesus is not there. Because divinity is not there. So the intercession is ultimately becoming one with the divine. You see, there are retreats going on, especially when you come to India. There are several retreat centers, especially in the state Kerala. But all those retreat centers, the success of those retreat centers depend on the group of intercessors who are in the retreat center 24 hours interceding before the Blessed Sacrament. You can notice that. When you visit these centers, look for that powerhouse in every retreat center. There are a few people 24 hours sitting in front of the Blessed Sacrament, interceding for the people who are in the retreat. So intercession, the importance of intercession. Success of the various mission, it is only through intercession. Since Brother Cyril John is organizing this Jericho 2020, I would like to say something about him. Today, the church, I would say, it's not an exaggeration, I would say, the church is blessed with such an anointed person, that is Brother Cyril John. I have never heard. Yes, we have been speaking of intercessions. We have been speaking of prayer of the faithful. We have been speaking of petitions during the mass and every our prayer meetings, etc., etc. But the Lord in a powerful way has touched our brother Cyril John, inspired him through his own life, made him to realize through his own life situations, hard life situations he had faced. And through that he has come out now the power of prophetic intercession. And the Lord has enabled him, used him powerfully, and he is now visiting every corner of the earth, every country, conducting this prophetic intercession course. There are so many people who have profited out of it. Lot of miracles have taken place, lot of changes have come to the nations. And that is why he is, the whole credit goes to him with the blessings of God upon him. And so in his life, the success of the mission that he is involved, he attributes to intercession. Many a times in a very joking way he used to say, I have two wives, both are intercessors. One wife, Sophie, she is in heaven. From heaven she is interceding for me. And another wife, Elsama, who is on the earth, she is interceding for me. So two powerful people interceding for me for the success of my mission. He depends on that intercession. Of course, his first wife, Sophie, died of cancer. And she is in heaven. She was such a holy woman. She is another intercessor for him. He depends on that. And now he has got, God has given him another woman in his life, the person of Elsama, another great warrior of intercession. I have witnessed this while I was traveling with these people, that the way 24 hours she is interceding. When Cyril is on the stage with the word of God, preaching the word of God, it is she who is sitting there and interceding for the power to come upon. So this, in his own life, he may not share this, that's why I shared with you. In his own life, he has experienced the power of intercession, and so he has developed this school of prophetic intercession, and today it is spread all over the world. Thanks to the grace of the Holy Spirit upon him. Then, I personally have, the intercession can change situations, change the hardest realities, changes the hardcore criminals, changes the most difficult situations. That is the power of intercession. As a young priest, I was appointed in one parish as the first parish priest in our diocese. There were no priests before that in that place. It was a bit of a difficult mission because the people were a bit difficult, very demanding, and the moral life was very low. They have been living very promiscuous life, something like ours, where St. John Mary Vianney was sent. It was something like that. Even when my bishop sent me there as a parish priest, he said, there is no place to stay, but you may stay in the nearby city parish and look after that. But I said, no, I will go. If you are sending me there, I will go deeper into that mission. I will stay with them. I did that. I had to face a lot of ridicules. But every day I used to spend 1 hour for the people, conversion of the people. I know in the initial stages, the youth used to come, go around the room where I was sitting. It was a classroom. I didn't have a priest's residence there. I was staying in a classroom. They used to go around, ridicule, howl, clap. They used to ridicule me. Even once when I was offering the Holy Eucharist on a mission Sunday, one of the parishioners stopped me And he told me, you are all the time praying. Why don't you do some mission work, some project work, some social work? I told, no, I am a spiritual person. I have come for to give you God. If you don't want, I will go away. I kept on to that. Finally, I started praying for them. I tried to visit the families, tried to meet the people. Nothing worked. Finally, I came down to myself, sat before the Lord, started pleading with the Lord, fasting and prayer. Initially, they were ridiculing. Then I realized once, one of them came to me and asked, what are you doing there? I said, I'm praying for you all. Then he said, can I also come and join you? I said, yes, most welcome. So he came and sat close to me. And I know those first few days, he used to only look at me like this, what I am doing. He was so distracted. But I accepted, I offered him to the Lord. He was touched. He realized. He was convinced. Then he started bringing his companions. Then became a group of 7 youth with me, daily there, assembling and praying. And then I told those 7 youth, a week, one day each one of you will pray and do some penance for the conversion of our parish. They started doing. So each day, each youth took up. They spent the time in prayer, fasting. And after some time, the women started joining us. Then slowly some men started joining. We could get the whole parish. When I was there, there were about 30, 40 families, Catholic families. And they joined. And then slowly it started. Then they started taking interest. They started talking to me. Then they said, we have to build a church. Then I said, yes. Of course, the bishop was generous. Some project was sanctioned. We put up the structure of the church. Then to all the necessary things to furnish the church with the sanctuary, with the altar, with all the needed things. I told the people, you have to do that. It's your church. They were always on the receiving end, but now they have changed and they started contributing. They started sponsoring every item in the church. The diocese built only the walls of the church. Rest all was contributed by the people, their own contribution. So they consider it as their own church. And it became a very vibrant faith community. And then we put up a beautiful exhibition. 6 months that exhibition was kept, Bible exhibition. People from all over the neighboring states came and witnessed that. And then I used to take some of the youth, when I used to go for preaching, the Triduum, the retreats, I used to take them along. They were getting experience, they were getting exposed. And it became one of the vibrant parish. Now it is more than 100 Catholic families there. So I would clearly say that it is the effect of intercession, the power of intercession. I know individual people, when they intercede, their life is being blessed abundantly. I know in one of the parish, an illiterate girl who had to do the household chores. And she was but amidst her hectic activities, looking after the home, all the others were studying, but she was not. But she was faithful to the daily Eucharist and the evening adoration and prayers. Every day without fail, she used to be there, an illiterate girl. And I used to be really taken up by that. But God blessed her in such a way, she got a very good husband, settled in marriage, now have 3 boys, children, and one of the boys joined the seminary. Vocation has come from that family. Again, the power of intercession for that family. Why don't we take up this such a powerful weapon, the mission of intercession? Then I have another example. One of my companion priests, an IMS priest, and he was studying with me, acute asthma patient. And he was so friendly with me, I introduced him to intercession through our Blessed Mother, Our Lady of Graces. and he interceded. He could get over that sickness. Today he is a powerful missionary. So there are cases, so many, I can go on enumerating so many examples of the power of intercession. I have another beautiful example of prophetic intercession. See, as a young priest, I had learned it from my father this. My father used to tell me, he was a spiritual person, he's no more. My father used to teach me as a young boy that at night when you sleep, sometimes your eyes open up, you wake up for no need of yours. Sometimes you need to go to the washroom, that's understandable. But there is nothing, suddenly your eyes open up and you wake up, then you turn the other side and sleep off. But my father told me, this is Jesus waking you up, because he needs at that moment, in any corner of the earth, someone is suffering, someone is in difficulties, that person needs intercession. So the Lord is waking you up. So that moment you should whisper a prayer to the Lord. Lord, take care of the one who is at the moment in need. You must pray and then you sleep. So he had taught me that, and I took it up and I started practicing that, not knowing what is happening. So I went on, it became a regular practice for me. Also when traveling, pray for those people whom we look at. Just offer them, lift them up to the Lord. Offering them, that is intercession. So I was going on doing this. But the Lord gave me confirmation. That is, once when I got an opportunity to attend a particular program which was arranged in Bangkok, and that was on School of Missionary Animators training. So from our diocese I was chosen. From India we were 4 or 5 people only. From all over the world there were representations for that beautiful training program. I was there. One day was allotted to Indians for the offering of the Holy Eucharist. So when I came, there were lay people too. I offered the Mass. After the Mass, during the breakfast, one gentleman, he is from Thailand, he came to me and said, Father, I have seen you before. I told him it was in 1991 something. That time the mobiles were not so, this internet was not developed. And so that was the time, only landlines existed. And I was, for the first time I am traveling out of India. So when he said, I have seen, I told, no, it cannot be. You must have seen someone like me. He told, no, Father, I think you. Because when he was in very big difficulties in the business. Everything went flat. He had to undergo a lot of problems. The business collapsed. And he was almost planning of committing suicide to come out of it. And that's the time, one day when he was desperately praying, he felt someone like me, my face, he says, someone came and prayed over him. And afterwards, some openings came in his business. Gradually, slowly, slowly, he could overcome that. And now today, he is very successful. So he was telling me to that. So first I didn't believe it. I just thought this person is just making things like that. But then later on, now of late, recently, when I had to visit Brazil, the mission that is being run by the MMI priests, I went to visit all their missions. In one interior mission in the Amazon area, and there one of the church, Ita Kuchiara, one place, there the MMI priest is working. So I went there, I offered the Holy Eucharist in Portuguese, I learned it. I offered the Mass. After the Mass, I came out, the people are coming and wishing, asking for blessing. And I was doing that and they were going away. Then at one moment, a lady comes, by name Gladys. She came, caught hold of my hands and started only crying and saying so many things in Portuguese. I couldn't understand. So I called for the priest and I asked him, what is she saying? So he listened and told me, she says, the moment you ascended on the altar, when she saw your face, she immediately was taken up Because she says in her life she is a cancer patient, and when the doctors had given up, she was in the last stage almost. That time she was in one night, she was going through a nightmare, terrible pain. She thought that she is going to die. But then she just turned to the Lord and started praying. And that time she says that someone like you had come over her and prayed over her. From that time onwards, she started experiencing some healing. And today she is fully cured. And so she was thanking me with the tears of gratitude. That's what he explained. Her name is Gladys. So when I heard these incidents, then I started realizing, maybe what I am doing by way of prophetic intercession, not knowing for whom I am praying for, that is taking place. The Lord is confirming. My dear brothers and sisters, this is such a powerful weapon. You don't have to meet the people. You don't have to travel. In your own place, in your own situation, you can do the powerful prophetic intercession, and that is going to change the world. So this is the importance of it, and we need to understand. There is an experience. Experience has taught many evangelists that whenever the church moves in prayer, there will be hunger and thirst created in non-believers for seeking God and for giving up the ways of the world. The church has to move in prayer. Jesus is doing that. And so we must join Jesus, and then there will be non-believers who will be coming seeking God. We have a beautiful example in our region, Matradhama Ashram. Totally, Varanasi is a Hindu center. And there, Swami Anil Dev is there. And he is conducting retreats and intercessions. And the effect of that prayer and fasting in that center has touched thousands of people. Today, thousands and thousands of non-Christians coming there for prayer and worship. They're not even baptized, but they have accepted Jesus as their God. And they know all the prayers. That is the power of intercession today. Such a wonderful ministry that is. The mission of intercession there in that Matradhama Ashram. Swami Anil Dev is doing it, and his collaborators. So there are so many examples when the church moves in prayer. A missionary to Argentina related a very interesting testimony. An outreach had been planned for Buenos Aires with much advanced planning. Every conceivable preparation had been made to make the event a success. A daily radio broadcast, thousands of leaflets being distributed, and newspaper publicity were all used to ensure a successful event. On the opening night, after weeks of hard toil and labor, when the speaker arrived, there were several empty chairs. People had not come. The expected crowd was missing. After this discouraging experience, the evangelist started to seek God for a genuine revival in the city through intercession. After weeks of intercessory prayer, the Lord spoke through a Bible college student. He said, God is going to perform mighty signs and wonders in Argentina, for the strong man of Argentina has been bound. Thereafter, there was another outreach event, and 250,000 people turned out every night in the sports arena of Buenos Aires. Wheelchairs and crutches discarded by those who were healed were carried away by truckloads after the meeting each night. It was powerful intercession that changed the situation. So these are the various examples that we have of the power of intercession. St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 4, in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. So we need intercession. Mission is not easy. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, the evil. Pope St. John Paul II, during his visit to the USA, stated, "There is a battle for the soul of this nation. There is a battle for the soul of this nation." That battle has to be fought with the weapon of intercession. Matthew chapter 21 verse 13, Jesus says, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." On the 28th of May 2018, Pope Francis, at the opening of the General Assembly of the Pontifical Missionary Works in Rome, said, "Prayer is the first missionary work." Pope Francis is thoroughly convinced of it. He said, "Prayer is the first missionary work that every Christian can and must accomplish, and it is also most effective, even if this effectiveness can't be measured." Very well said. In his apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudium, that is the joy of the gospel, Pope Francis says, he had, for that encyclical, he had set aside a subheading on the missionary power of intercessory prayer. You read the joy of the gospel, Evangelii Gaudium, there is a particular section Pope Francis has devoted for the missionary power of intercessory prayer. Paragraph 281 says, Evangelii Gaudium, "One form of prayer moves us particularly to take up the task of evangelization and to seek the good of others. It is the prayer of intercession." Pope Francis is saying, it is the prayer of intercession. Again, para 283, Evangelii Gaudium, "The great men and women of God were great intercessors." As Pope John Paul II, what did he say? A true believer is an intercessor. What Pope Francis, during his Wednesday audience on 18th June 2020, what did he say? Intercession makes one a true believer. So, great men and women of God were great intercessors. Intercession is like a leaven in the heart of the Trinity. It is a way of penetrating the Father's heart and discovering new dimensions which can shed light on concrete situations and change them. We have the umbrella demonstration. That is, you see an umbrella, it has got a stem and it has got spokes. The stem of the umbrella and the spokes of the umbrella. The spokes are different ministries which take place in the church. Education apostolate, health apostolate, social development, etc., etc. So these are the spokes of the umbrella. But the stem which holds all these different ministries, that is intercession. That's a beautiful example. So the stem is intercession, which holds every ministry in the church. Then, Saint Benedict's rule, Saint Benedict, the great monastic, his rule was 8 hours of prayer, 8 hours of work, and 8 hours of rest. 8 hours of prayer, 8 hours of work, 8 hours of rest. That's what the monk Saint Benedict said. The church has appointed two patrons for missionary work. And these are the two, Saint Francis Xavier and the Little Flower. Saint Francis Xavier is my patron saint. I have special devotion to him. We belong to him, his missionary work in the south of India. And then Saint Francis Xavier was declared much early as the patron of the missions, because he has done wonderful work. Left his own country, came to India, Japan, and various other places, traveled far and wide, gathered children, gathered people, walked miles and miles, taught them prayers, catechized them, baptized everyone, established various churches. What a great missionary activity that Saint Francis Xavier did. When he writes to Saint Ignatius, he writes very clearly, I don't have even time to eat. I don't have even time to pray my prayers, because the people are flocking me. They want to listen to the gospel. They want to experience God. So I have no time. I'm so busy. Such a busy person in the missionary activity. It was right and fitting that church declared him as the patron of the missions. After some time, when I heard that the little flower, Saint Teresa of Lisieux, she also is declared equally with Saint Francis Xavier as the patroness of the mission, I started wondering, what the church is doing? What a bad comparison. What did this little flower do? Lived only 24 years, died at the age of 24. She was a tuberculosis patient. She lived in the four walls of the convent. A cloistered nun. She never saw the world. How could she be a missionary? But then I realized she was interceding. She was, every moment she was interceding. Every work that she did became an intercession. When she was washing her clothes, every beating on the stone of the cloth, she offered it for the salvation of souls. Every step she walked, she offered it. Every time she swept the floor, every swing of the broom, she offered it. She breathed the mission through the intercession. And that's why it's right and fitting that she had lived the essence of mission, and that is intercession. See the importance of intercession. St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verse 31, we read, so whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God, as the little flower did. Do everything for the glory of God. That's why intercession is every moment affair. It's not just a particular time I'm going to intercede. No. Every moment of our life has to become an intercession. Our life has to become intercession. St. John Mary Vianney, another beautiful example. St. John Mary Vianney, he was born during the French Revolution. And then that time, we cannot practice the religion. So he could not have the essential elementary catechism and all those type of things. In a hiding way, he was learning. And then when he was much older, he was baptized, he receives the sacrament. That's how he comes up. And then they say that he joined the seminary. He could not cope up with the studies. Many people say that St. John Mary was a Buddha. Means he didn't have any brains, that's why he could not study. Not at all. He was a clever person. But he lacked the elementary education because of the situation of his country, revolution. He lacked the elementary education. So later on, for him to study those higher subjects, it was difficult for him. But grace worked. He interceded. His life was an intercession. Then he was ordained a priest. Then the intellectuals thought that he is a dumper. He cannot do anything. And so can't be entrusted with great responsibilities. They sent him to that forsaken place called Ars. There he went and transformed it into heaven. That hell-like place he went and interceded throughout. He spends nights and nights in prayer interceding. And today it is a pilgrim center. The same people who thought that he is worth nothing, he's a donkey. The same bishops, the same priests, those intellectuals disguised, is to come to him for confession. Such a rich spiritual knowledge he had. He was such a wise saint. How did he get that? He got that through the power of intercession. Why we need to pray for? The Lord has said, pray for more laborers. Matthew chapter 9, verse 37 to 38. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. To see the harvest, John 4, verse 35. Do not say, 4 months more, then comes the harvest. But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. For boldness and we need to intercede also for boldness in mission. Acts chapter 4 verse 23 to 31. We also have to intercede for the removal of the blocks in the mission that we are involved with. When we face challenges in the mission, we need to intercede to face those challenges with conviction and power. For abundant fruits in mission, we need to pray for 100-fold fruit. Galatians chapter 4 verse 19, St. Paul writing, my little children, for whom I am again in the pain of childbirth, until Christ is formed in you. My little children, for whom I am again in the pain of childbirth, until Christ is formed in you. Indirect mission through intercession, setting souls free from the captivity of sin and bondage. When the church moves in prayer, in intercession, the Lord will bring in plenty of laborers. Be sure of it. When the church moves in intercession, mountains will move and strongholds will come down. When the church moves in intercession, gates will be opened for mission. When the church moves in intercession, thirst and hunger will be created in non-believers to receive God's word. When the church moves in intercession, signs and wonders will accompany the proclamation. When the church moves in intercession, multitudes would be cut to heart and be baptized. When the church moves in intercession, the church will grow and become vibrant and a witnessing community. We had a beautiful example of in the person of Swami Augustine Dinabandhu, a Capuchin priest who was living in Kareli ashram in the diocese of Bareilly. I was very much associated with him. He remained such a clever man. He remained in that humble ashram with thatched roof, huts, with a cow dung laid floor. Very humble, with a frugal living. He was a great example. Many went to remain with him. He, of course, he is in heaven. But about him, there is a book written. In that book, the title of that book is St. Francis of Assisi on Indian Roads. St. Francis of Assisi on Indian Roads. When we, a group of 12 people from the Diocese of Meerut, I too was one of them, I was a priest that time. We went there, spent 9 days of praying and fasting. 9 days we spent in prayer and fasting. Then the 12 of us were divided into 3 groups of 4 each. And we were sent to unknown villages to live 1 week and evangelize the whole village and come back with an experience. Not taking anything, literally following the way in the gospel. Luke chapter 9, Luke chapter 10, how Jesus sent the disciples. Literally in that way, we didn't take any eatable, any money, any bag, any purse. Only the Eucharistic kit to celebrate the Eucharist every day. We went and that was a wonderful experience. 1 full week in an unknown pagan village. We lived there, walked around, met the people. We had hardships, but we faced the strength we got. We cured so many people. Bedridden people started walking. We were so powerful. How did we get that power? 9 days of praying and fasting. That empowered us. So the power of intercession we have so beautifully. With the charismatic renewal, intercession has become powerful. We read in Ezekiel, the book of Ezekiel, chapter 22, verse 30. I looked for someone who could stand between me and the people. I could not find. So today we are here, Jericho 2020, all the participants. We should answer, Lord, here I am, to stand in between, to stand in the breach, to intercede with you. We should be able to come out. Genesis chapter 18, verse 23 to 33, we read about how Abraham intercedes for Sodom and Gomorrah. He asks, what a freedom Abraham has got with God. So freely he is talking to God. That is what intercession makes us. He asks, Lord, if there are only 50 good people, will you save? If there are only 30, 20, 10, how could he bargain with God? Intercession gives the power to bargain with God. It's such a mighty power, that prayer of intercession. Moses, in Exodus chapter 17, verse 8 to 13, war with Amalekites. Joshua fighting the Amalekites. Moses on the top mountain praying, supported by Aaron and Hur. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 11, we read, whenever Moses held up his hand in intercession for Israel, the Israel prevailed. And whenever he lowered his hand, Amalekites prevailed. So, the power of intercession. Psalm 106, verse 23, had not Moses, the chosen one, stood in the breach? The psalmist is also glorifying Moses' role as an intercessor. Had not Moses, the chosen one, stood in the breach? Again, Exodus 32, verse 32. But now, this is another power. When you are in the mission of intercession, we can challenge God. So that's what we find here, Moses telling to God. Exodus chapter 32, verse 32. But now, Lord, if you will forgive the people, otherwise, if you don't forgive, blot out my name from your book. If you don't forgive, blot out my name from your book. It's a challenge. That's what intercession, the power of intercession. And we see the Lord forgives the whole lot due to the prayer of the chosen one, Moses, interceding for them. Acts chapter 12, verse 2 to 5. Peter was imprisoned. He was under the supervision of 16 soldiers. He was put in the innermost cell. But the church prayed, lifted the hands and prayed, interceded. And what was the outcome? Peter was miraculously saved. That is the power of intercession. Luke chapter 18, verse 1 to 8. The Lord, in order to teach them that they should pray and not lose heart, says, will not God do justice to his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Again, Romans chapter 8, verse 34. It is pleasing in the sight of Jesus because he himself is interceding. By intercession, we are joining in the mission of Jesus at this very moment. So every time when we travel, when we work, we sanctify the moments. We pray for the people. So this is the most powerful weapon the Lord has given to us in the present day when we are living in the midst of evil, challenges and all unholy activities that is taking place and mankind is being distorted. We have this powerful weapon. Let us take up this weapon and join with Jesus in interceding for the world, for the church, for every family and for every human being. And intercession is a mission. Let us pray to the Lord that we may become powerful intercessors with Jesus, who is at the right hand of the Father. Amen.